So the topic for tonight's reflection is related to the happiness. Happiness is a very subjective topic. If I asked to each one of you here, what do you consider a happiness? I can assure you that you're going to mention different answers. And worse than that, if I talk to you today, maybe tomorrow you're going to present a different view for the happiness. And if you go back to your younger days, for sure, the happiness would be very, very different from today. So when we were a kid, probably what would be happiness? To receive a candy, to receive a lollipop, to play with friends. And now, what is the happiness now? Health? Money. So different stages for the happiness. And the happiness key, I'm so sorry. And the happiness key, it's something that the humankind is in quest, is searching, I think since the beginning, along with something that give you a permanent youth, right? Like a youth potion, something like that. So what's the reason that the humankind never found the happiness key? Can someone guess? What's the reason that we never found that?
Because happiness is within.
Exactly. Because we do the search. If you didn't find, it's because we are not searching the right place. And usually we are searching where? Outside. I'm going to get money. I'm going to get a new home, a new car, a new boyfriend, a new girlfriend, right? It's always outside. And actually, we should search the happiness inside, right? It's individual. As I said, it's different for me. It's different for any of you. Which means that if it's different, why are you trying to make a search or a quest in the same direction, which is outside, right? Make sense? So based on that think, the happiness keys is actually the quest for self-knowledge. That's what we are going to talk here and make the link to the happiness. What self-knowledge is related to the happiness? That's what we are going to talk today. And let me exemplify here. Does any of you know this girl right here? You know this girl? What's the name?
Mafalda.
Exactly. Her name is Mafalda. Kino, it was Argentina, a cartoonist and philosopher, right? I think he published this cartoon in the newspaper on a daily basis for more than 20 years. Initially, I thought that Mafalda, she was very ludic, very childish. But actually, it's not. When I start to read again Mafalda, look at this one right here. Mafalda is stopping at the locksmith, and Mafalda is asking to an old guy here, an old man here. Good morning, sir. Could you please make me a happiness key? The wise man here, because you see, Kino draw an old guy here, which means experience, right? Knowledge. And what did he answer to her? Give me the model, and then I can give you the key. There is no model for that, because we are completely different from each other. There is no model for the happiness key. So you see how deep is this cartoon here? Seems very childish, but look at that. The old guy representing experience, and the young one, Mafalda, is coming here. I need the happiness key. Give me the model, I give you the key. Right? Make sense? Okay, references for today. Kardec wrote 5 books plus a monthly magazine. The 5 books, first one, The Spirit's Book. Second one, The Medium's Book. The third one, The Gospel According to Spiritism. The fourth one, Heaven and Hell. And the fifth one, The Genesis. Okay? We are going to concentrate our reflection today on The Spirit's Book, for sure. And I'm going to show you the link between the happiness and the self-knowledge. The same way I'm going to use The Gospel According to Spiritism. The Spirit's Book was written into 4 parts. If you are not so familiar, 4 parts basically. And all the 4 parts generate the other remaining books that I mentioned. Okay? This one right here, it's related to The Gospel According to Spiritism. It's not a new Bible. It's where Kardec presents examples of the moral laws under the gospel. The moral laws are introduced in the part 3 of the Spirit's Book. And here Kardec went a little bit deeper in The Gospel According to Spiritism. Okay? So we're going to use those 2 books. And this first one right here, it's a pretty nice book from Joana de Angelis, The Spirit, where she presents a way for us to perform a self-knowledge. The book is not so thick. It's like this, maybe 100 and a couple pages. But you need to read it, study. Joana de Angelis, she shortened in a short paragraph a lot of information. You need to read sometimes 2 or 3 times the same paragraph to get the message. But it's a pretty good book that I suggest if you wanna go to this trip internally, right? And search for your happiness key. Okay? Any questions so far? No? Okay. So let's make the link between the happiness, as I mentioned in the books from Kardec. In The Gospel According to Spiritism, in the chapter 5, blessed are the afflicted. This message here, it's inside the Sermon of the Mountain. Okay? In the chapter 5, item 18, to suffer well or badly. Look at the logic that Kardec was presenting here. He was talking about is suffering well or suffering badly. Okay? Do you know the difference? Does any one of you know the difference here?
Attitude.
I would say attitude is always, but the difference will be choice. It's the choice. It's your free will to see I'm going to suffer well, which means that I'm going to learn from my suffering. If I decide to suffer badly, it means that I'm going to complain. Right? So it's a personal choice. You want to suffer badly, complaining, not solving, blaming others, or you're going to receive your suffering and make that suffer a lemonade. Right? Get the lemon and make a lemonade. Make it like a lesson to learn to your life. Every suffering that we are performing is for us to re-educate. It's not to punish at all. It's for us to rethink about your life. Rethink about of what you are doing. Right? And re-educate yourself. So that's the concept behind the suffer well or badly. Pretty related to happiness, right? Evil and its remedy. Oh. I'm not doing any spoiler. I would ask you to go there and read. Item 19. And then look at the item 12, the item 20. Happiness is not of this world. Wow, what I'm doing here? Why am I doing here? I'm not going to be happy, even if I make good choices and so. So let's revisit that thing here. What Kardec is saying here is that because the Earth is under evolution, and the current stage that we have at on Earth, it's not for happiness, it's for suffering. And the suffering, we need to decide if we're going to suffer well or badly, right? And the world here means the material world. The happiness is not in the material world. It's in the things that we are going to bring for the eternal life. So you see the logic that he presented here? Does it make sense? Right? We've got the afflicted, and then at the end he mentioned about happiness is not in this world. So we need to read and understand that. Now let's go to the Spirit's book. Part 4, hopes and consolations. If we are going to suffer, we need some kind of hope and consolation, right, to compensate. If not, it's going to be tough for us to go on a daily basis. The first chapter of this part is indicating the earthly joys and sorrows. Happiness, right? But pay attention to here. Questions 920. To 933, relative happiness and unhappiness. It's relative. It's depending on us. But keep in mind this number right here, 920, okay? Why I'm saying that thing, the 920, the question 920? What is coming before the 920? Before the 920. 990. Keep that number in your mind. Okay? Is it okay here?
Yeah.
Good topics for a homework? Okay? 990. You see, right before a chapter mentioning about happiness, Kardec presented what? What is the most effective means for improving ourselves in this life and for resisting the drag of evil? What does that mean, the drag of evil? Unhappiness, right? If I'm dragged by the evil, I'm going to be unhappy, right? Look at the answer provided by the spirits. A sage of antiquity, before Jesus, much before Jesus, 700 years, around 700 before Jesus. Know thyself. Period. No more to answer in this question. Okay? And this is presented at the entrance of the temple of Apollo in the Delphos island in Greece. Around 700 before Jesus. Make sense here? Do you have any questions here? Probably you got a question. If you don't have a question, I'll be surprised. That picture is the image that we make for ourselves. We don't know ourselves, right? But know thyself. How can we do that? Don't you have this question? How can I do that? What's the formula? Right? Let's see if we can answer. Let's go back to our friend here. What is self-knowledge? What is self-knowledge by definition? Let's see what Mafalda is bringing here. She came to his friend Joe and found a book with this great advice, know thyself. Joe asked to see the book. And Joe is asking, where's the mirror? Why? Because we are searching for that thing outside. Not inside. Know thyself, it's not going to the mirror and see if my hair is becoming gray, to see if I'm getting fat. No, this is external. Let's see internal. So, let's see by definition what is a self-knowledge. It's an intimate knowledge that a person has about himself. So if I make a comparison, what we know about ourselves, it's written by psychologists. What we know about ourselves, it's like a cork in an ocean. The ocean is our entirety, our self. That's what we know, is just a cork floating in the ocean. We don't know anything about us. That's the exercise that we are going to promote and try to motivate each one of us today to perform this trip. It's an individual investigation, which means that we need to investigate. It's a labor. It's an effort. No one is going to do it for us. We should do it ourselves. To identify what are the most striking characteristics, tastes, inclinations, behaviors, feelings, etc. Right? It's to know ourselves. Fully understanding of our actions and feelings. Why I am feeling that way. Why I don't like this person talking that way. Can I give you an exercise? Try to put on a paper 5 topics that you don't like to see in another person. If you put these 5 features that you don't like in another person, probably most of them are inside you. And you don't perceive. Try to do this exercise. This is Carl Jung. It's not Carl Jung and Freud, they are the masters of psychoanalysts. Okay? What is not self-knowledge? What is not? Trying to fit by the feelings of others or by the effort of others. Right? It's to adjust yourself because you want to be perfect for others. This is an egoic situation. It's your ego saying that you should do that. It's not yourself. It's not your personality. Right? It's not blindly absorbing the opinion of others about us. It's a good reference. So there's a phrase, a common phrase, that the one that knows you better is your enemy. But don't take that thing blindly, because you need to do the exercise yourself. It's not only asking, what do you think about me? If you ask to others, what do you think about me? You are actually indicating that you are not so secure about your position. You need to see how the others are seeing you, not the way that you are seeing yourself. Okay? It's not to provide attitudes with an egoic purpose. It's pretty common. We change ourselves to be good in the picture, right? To present yourself to the community, but it's against you to do that thing. So when you've got the egoic purpose, it means that you are selfish. Your ego is dominating you. It's like the cork trying to control the ocean. The cork cannot control the ocean. Right? So this is not self-knowledge. Is it clear here? Make sense? Let's go deeper. Let me give an example of a feeling that we sometimes hide. Envy. Pretty common, right? We are all good here. We don't feel that thing. We don't envy anyone. We are all perfect here. Right? Of course not. So there was a survey in Brazil in 2006, not so far from today. I think the world didn't change so much. So they interviewed around 2,000 people there in Brazil. 73% knew about envy. They could say, oh, I know what's envy. Envy is like that. 84% said they were never envious. 84%. And 75% said that someone invited them. So the numbers does not match, right? It's something missing here. I'm not inviting anyone, and 75% is saying that someone is inviting me. It's not matching. This thing presents to us that lying to yourself is always the worst lie. That's a basic for the self-knowledge, right? If you try to lie to yourself, you're going to adjust your behavior based on your ego, which means that you're going to feed your ego. And then if you feed your ego, it's growing, 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 and then you become selfish. Does it make sense? Very logic, right? Is that okay here? Let's see. In practice, what was the number of the question that Kardec answered with a short sentence? 9? 1? 9. So Kardec was not happy with that thing. So I like to say that. So you just answer with that thing. So easy, right? So Kardec put the question 919A. We comprehend all the wisdom of the maximum, know thyself. But the difficulty is precisely in knowing ourselves. It's pretty difficult. It's not so simple. By what means can we do so? Good question, right? That's why I ask it all of you here, if you have a question after the question 919. We all should have. I don't know how to do the self-knowledge. So think God and thank our spiritual friends that St. Augustine, the great St. Augustine, signed the answer of this question. So let's see here. Do what I used to do when I lived on earth, when I was incarnated. St. Augustine in spirit, okay? At the end of the day, it's not at the end of the year, it's not at the end of the week. It's at the end of every day. It's a daily exercise. I would question myself, review what I had done, and ask myself if I hadn't failed to do some duty. Reflect what you did. If no one had had reason to complain about me, it's to put yourself on the view of the others. That's how I got to know myself and see what in me needed reform. So, for example, if you scream to another person, so when you go bed at night, you're going to remember that thing. Why did I scream to him? If it's the opposite, he was screaming at me, what do I think about him? So then you start your self-knowledge, right? This daily exercise. And look at the second here and ask even more. If God to call me at this moment, disincarnated, would I have to fear the look of someone? Would I be ashamed of someone? When entering again in the world of the spirits where nothing can be hidden. It's like you expose yourself. So, good exercise on a daily basis. Daily basis. Then you start to know yourself. You start to identify your virtues. You start to identify your weakness, your bad actions, and so on. Make sense? Is it difficult or is it hard? Or both? Both, right? It's difficult and hard. Okay. The self-knowledge is a continuous process. As I said, every day, right? How does this start? This starts with an analysis. What is an analysis? It's an intimate identification of our attitudes and feelings. If I don't like someone's attitude, why I don't like that? When you think about cause and effect, what are you feeling? It's exactly the effect. Try to identify the cause, right? After the analysis, we have what? Evaluation. What is an evaluation? It's a reflection, right? Here, you gather the information. Here, you evaluate. Understanding the suffering. Why I'm suffering because of this? It's my ego. It's my proudness. Right? If we squeeze the suffering, for sure you're going to find selfish and proudness. Because these two right here, they are cousins. The selfishness is the root cause in most of the cases. Okay? Reflection of our attitudes and feelings. Let's reflect. Why I'm acting that way? Why I'm screaming to someone? Why I'm acting that way? Right? The next one will be action. Here we gather the information, evaluate. Now you need to act. And act means what? Perform corrections. Or, if it's not possible, accept it. At least you know yourself. Right? Can I give you a tip to memorize this cycle here? Everybody here used to go to the doctor, right? When you go to the doctor, you've got some kind of scope. So I've got a pain in my knee. That's the scope. The scope is right here. Know myself. Know thyself, right? Analysis is when your doctor asks you to go to MRI to get a blood work, to take another exam, X-ray. That's the analysis. And then when you have the results of the exams, you go back to the doctor and he performs the evaluation. Identify what treatment you need to do, the action. And so on, and so on, and so on, and so on. Make sense? It's easier now? A little bit, right? A little bit easier. But that's the way, that's the process. Remember the physician, and you know what to do. Every day at night, let's follow whatever was presented by St. Augustine. Every day at night, gather the information, evaluate, and identify the actions to perform. Every day, every day, every day, every day. It's a daily exercise. And it's free. It doesn't cost anything. But it should be done only by us. You cannot outsource that. You cannot ask them, do that thing for me, make analysis, make the evaluation, proceed from it. No, it's no way. You need to do that thing yourself. That's the problem, because we are still very lazy and we don't like to perform something that it's hard. If it's hard, I'm going to push back. I'm going to do it later, next year. It's like a diet, right? Every Monday we start a new diet. Every Monday, right? Because you are pushing back because it's not funny. This sometimes is not so funny because it will present to you something that you are trying to avoid, to know about yourself. Right? It's quite tough to say, I'm very selfish. Remember the envy? The envy survey? I'm not envy. And actually, you are envy. Right? Make sense? So quiet. Okay, Joana de Angelis, in The Happy Life, the book that Tim presented in the Vibrations, right? Chapter 111, good number, good to memorize, right? Examine your conscience whenever you can, as often as possible. Once again, remember that it's continuous, it's often. Many complaints and complaints would disappear if the discontent person analyzed his own behavior better. So it's Saint Augustine here, right? Joan de Angelis is just saying what Saint Augustine mentioned in the 919a. In other words, have the courage, look at that here, courage to examine yourself more severely. It's a courage. Remembering attitudes and words, what you did during the day, what you speak, what you mention. When discovering errors, hasten to correct them. Seek out the one you hurt and put the situation back together. Fix it. Remember the cycle? What's the first one in the cycle? Analysis. Second one, evaluation. Third one, action. What Joana is saying here? Analysis, evaluation, and action. In a continuous way. Often, right? And the final message here, do not insist in an error. Do not maintain in an error, whatever the justification is. An error is an error. If you recognize your error, try to fix it. At least make your effort to fix it. Forgive, whatever you need. Make sense? A checklist. That's a good point here. Let me do a checklist for that. So we talk about the continuous process. So then we need to understand that self-knowledge is a continuous and a very long-term process, individual process. You're not going to know yourself in the next day. It's a continuous process, continuous process, continuous process. And maybe we are not going to finish in this life. You're going to do that thing, continue the next incarnation, and so on, and so on, and so on. Right?
Think the most of people die and
they don't know anything about them. It's like the cork in the ocean. Right? They're still at the cork situation. Yes, you're right. Agree? First one to check. Second one. Quite tough. Recognize mistakes. First point. And then perform the assessment of the mistakes. As they may be an exposure of our own features, our own way of life, our own personality, not yet known. So get your error. My suggestion is that if you identify an error, express your gratitude. Because someone is pointing to you where you should improve. Someone is facilitating your life to know yourself. Look at that. Instead of complain, I made a mistake, I don't make mistakes. Good, thank God. You helped me on identifying my mistake. Because my mistake is probably, I would say 99%, a feature that you didn't perceive. Right? That's a good point here. Can I ask you, I think you know the story here, the blind Bartimaeus. It's presented in Mark 10:51 and Matthew 20:32. The blind Bartimaeus, he was blind and he was like a beggar close to the, I think it was in the way between Jericho and Jerusalem. He was sitting close to the way using a cap. A cap is because the Romans, for you to be a beggar in the street, the Romans gave a cap. then you are authorized to beg in the street. Bartimeu, he was a blind one. And a blindness at this time, it's a completely outside of the society. So it's a beggar. So what Bartimeu did, Bartimeu was sitting close to the way. And so Jesus was coming with a lot of people around him. And he was screaming to Jesus. The first thing that Bartimeu did, Bartimeu threw away the cap. It's a symbolic thing, right? It means that he gave away about the to be a beggar, a permanent beggar. And he came to Jesus. So what Jesus asked him, what do you want me to do to you? Does any one of you here is capable if Jesus is presented in front of your face? Are you capable to answer promptly this answer? That's a basic question for self-knowledge. It's quite difficult to answer. Imagine if Jesus stopped in front of you. What do you want me to do? Someone would say, I would like health. Health for what? What you're going to do with your health? Oh, I need money. Money for what? Right? Try to answer this question. It's quite tough. Quite tough to answer. And by the way, this is the only miracle performed by Jesus that there is a name. All the other ones, you're going to see the widow or someone in the street or the blindness of something, but this is the only one that Jesus gave a name. In the gospel, it was presenting a name, Bartimeu. So keep that thing in mind. Try to do this exercise at home. If Jesus stops in front of you, what do you want me to do? Are you capable to answer? Promptly, like Bartimeu. What Bartimeu answered to him? I want to see. Throw away the cap. I want to see. Simple. Right? Okay, let's continue this checklist here. According to Carl Jung, it's presented in this book here. Unfortunately, it's only in Portuguese. It's a pretty good one. It's written by Joana de Angelis, the Spirit, and other psychologists in Brazil that also study the Spiritism. And they bring that information in the chapter 4 of this book. Translation of the name of the book is Mirrors of the Soul. It's a pretty good one, by the way. According to Carl Jung, which is one of the fathers of the psychoanalysis, self-knowledge requires of us courage. Remember that we mentioned in the message from Joana de Angelis, courage. To doubt what we thought we were. So if you think that you are so good, questioning that. Be humble. Persistent. To follow a road that we don't know for sure where it will be. Because we don't know ourselves, right? As I said, the cork in the ocean. Does the cork know the ocean? Probably not. So you need to be persistent on doing the exercise. And the last one, but not the least, humility. Be humble to find our shadow. What is the shadow? The shadow is exactly what I said to you to do the exercise. What you don't like in others, write down. Probably this is your shadow. This is what you don't see, and it's inside of you, right? To find our shadow, confront and reconcile with it, okay? The shadow is linked to everything we see in the other. It's what's inside us, and we often don't realize it because it's unconscious. It's the ocean. Right? Make sense here? Are you following? It hurts? No. Okay, courage, persistence, humility. Courage for what? Courage for what? To challenge yourself. I'm not the one that I'm thinking I am. Right? I'm not better than anyone. Right? I'm selfish. You need to put that thinking in mind. Persistent. Right? Keep it. Keep it. Daily exercise. Daily exercise. And humility. If you recognize that you got this feature, try to fix it. If you cannot fix it, be happy with that. That's the key. Got it? Checklist done? Now we all know what to do, right? Conclusion for the happiness key. Joana de Angelis, in this book that I presented in the beginning of the presentation, the need, therefore, for self-discovery in a rational overview, that's the beauty of the Spiritism. The Spiritism does not submit anything, force anything. Spiritism is inviting us on a daily basis to think. The rational faith, right? Believe it, but try to understand the logic behind. Becomes urgent in order to favor recovery when in a state of disharmony or growth if it bears latent intrinsic values. You're going to identify your virtues, you're going to identify your defects, and then you can live with that. When we identify a problem, right, we solve 50% of the problem. The other 50% is to fix the problem. So that's the message here that Joana is mentioning to us. Good things. Of course. That you can do that.
People had one bad self-image, right? I don't have skills, I don't have... No.
Yeah, that's a consequence of the self-esteem, right? Your self-esteem. If you got another a good self-esteem, you're going to diminish yourself. But it doesn't mean that you know yourself. That's what you said. When you know yourself and identify the virtues, your self-esteem will become higher, right? You're not diminish yourself because I'm capable to do something that I cannot imagine that I'm capable to do. That's a good point. Thank you. So the task of self-knowledge depends. That's a good news here, right? Good news here. Depends solely and exclusively on ourselves. You do not need to pay anyone. Right? It's just on us. No excuse to postpone, to push back. If you're giving excuse to do so, it's because you don't want to do. Right? It's not your priority. Therefore, the happiness key is what? It's exactly what you said in the beginning. It's within us, right? Accessible by our own efforts. You do not need to go like Mafalda, go to a locksmith and ask someone to give you the happiness. Don't go to a car dealer and ask him to give you a new car. Because the new car in a couple of years will be an old car. And you're not going to be happy with that. Right? And then you need a new car again, a new car again, a new car again. And your happiness is what? It's not that. Right? So, happy life again, right? Happiness, happy life. Makes sense. What Shuan is bringing to us, don't dissipate, right? Your happiness is possible. It's possible. It's not something, it's not in this world. It's possible. Believe in this reality and work hard to achieve it. Don't set happiness in things. Look at that, external. In places, right? Or in people. Important thing here. We try to find our happiness in another one, in a friend, in a husband, in someone that you cannot control, so that you won't be disappointed. Happiness is an intimate state flowing from the well-being that a dignified and eventful life provides. Even if you lack money, a prominent social position, or health, you can be happy living with resignation and trust in God. I can give you an example. When I live in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, there was a young guy that he was living in a bed. He is tetraplegic from the neck below, no movements. So he, someone was dragging his bed with him on top of the bed in the streets. I used to live close to the beach, and he was also going to the beach with his friends, right? And people was, the friends were carrying him. They create some kind of a plastic, right? And put the water inside. They get him and put there. And when I was watching that scene at the beach, the guy was very happy. And I cannot understand, how can you be happy in this situation? How can you be happy with that? Right? And now I understand, after the reflection, the studies, I can understand why he was happy and much, much happier than anyone in the beach, maybe. Because he knew himself. And he trusts that what he's suffering in this situation is a temporary one. Right? Is a temporary one. So exactly what Joana mentioned here, even if you lack money, social position, health, you can be happy living with resignation. He cannot fix the situation. But he can believe in God. He can be happy. Right? That's a good example. It's a real example. It's not a fake story, by the way. My wife here, she knows that this guy, right? At the beach, in a bed. So, let's improve the vibration a little bit here. And let's bring just the music here for us to go home a little bit happier. Okay? Sound. 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 It's okay? No, no, no. Okay, let's see if it will work. No sound. Okay. So sorry, we've got time. Let's see. Say a prayer.
Don't worry, be happy.